Get on this one here. Everybody have your Bible here. Let's get started if we can. I'll try to get us out of here by 1 o'clock. All right. No, I'm just teasing. All right. Here we go. Everybody repeat this with me if you would, please. This is God's word that I hold in my hand. Upon God's word, I take my stand. I can have what it says I can have. I can do what it says I can do. I am what it says I am. And I will do what it tells me to do. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. If you meant to give the Lord Jesus a praise clap offering. All right, praise the Lord. I'll tell you a quick little funny. I've told this one before, but I like it. It just reminds me of some folks that might be here at the church this morning, okay? Anyway, there was this man and this woman. They were sitting out on their front porch in the evening time, and in a good summertime there, and they was just rocking along there, this little elderly man and his little wife. And she said, you know, she said, whenever we were young, said we'd sit on this porch swing, and you'd sit over there real close to me. And so anyway, he got the hint. He's a smart old guy. And he slid right over there. And anyway, they were sitting there rocking a little bit more. She said, you know, whenever we sat here on this swing in the summertime when we were young, you'd put your arm around me. And he said, well, okay. So anyway, he slid his arm around his little bride there. And they continued to rock. And she said, you know, whenever we sat on this swing when we was young, you'd sit real close to me and put your arm around me and you'd lean over and you'd nibble on my ear. And he gets up and starts into the house. He said, wait, where are you going? He said, I'm going to get my teeth. There you are. I'm sorry. I'm sorry if that fits you. I don't know. Got a lot to look forward to. Some of you got a lot to look forward to. So don't forget. Okay. All right. Here we go. Let's open up our Bibles to the Gospel of Luke today. And we're going to be looking at a very familiar passage of Scripture. I love this passage. I've preached out of it many, many times, and I just know that the Lord led me back to this for a number of reasons this morning, and I just pray that this passage of Scripture will truly come alive in all of our hearts here today. There's a lot of relevant information here for all of us here today, and I trust that you came expecting the Lord to bless. Somebody say amen. Amen. I want you to let the Lord speak to you today and make some changes in your life to help you, to inspire you, give you some insight, okay? Let's look, if you will, Luke chapter 15, verse number 11 through verse number 24 is what we're going to be reading today. And he said, a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divided unto them his living, and not many days after the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want, and he went and joined himself to a citizen of that land, of that country, and sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would fain have filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father's have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger. I will arise and go to my father, and I will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion on, and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe and put it on him, put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found, and they begin to be merry. And we'll stop right there. Let us pray. Father in heaven, I'm so grateful this morning for the precious word of God. Thank you, Father, for the Holy Spirit who is here this morning to quicken this written word, causing it to come alive to every man, woman, and child. Father, I just pray that lives will be touched and lives will be changed in this service today to your glory and your honor. Lord, I ask you now just hear this prayer. Father, if there's one soul here today that's unsaved, may today be the day that person accepts Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. Lord, if there's anyone here that's been in a backslidden condition, may today be the day of repentance and rededication. I just pray now for the Spirit of God to move powerfully in this service and help us all, Lord, to just line up with your word. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Would you put your hand over your heart? Come on, everybody can say this prayer. Put your hand over your heart and let's say this prayer to our Heavenly Father. Father in heaven, speak to my heart and change my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you very much for saying that prayer with me. I have a message I've entitled, A Portrait of Love. We all love a love story. And in fact, the Bible is a love story. from the beginning to the end, it is a love story of God's great love for all of us. And I pray that as we look into this morning, that the scriptures will come alive to you and you'll recognize the love of our Heavenly Father. But also may it, if you will, do a great work in our life of helping us to be the men and women that God wants us to be here upon this earth. Okay, let's look, if we will, verse number 11 and 12. And he said, a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divided unto them his living. I think the first thing that I like about this wonderful story here in the Bible that we're looking at, this wonderful truth that we're looking at this morning, it reveals to us some characters in the heart of a loving father here. And the first thing that I would say, the father believed in providing care for his family. Amen. He believed in providing for his family. I think that that's such an important thing. I pray that every man in here this morning is doing your part to provide for your family, that you understand the significance here. Here's a father that's he's worked hard and he's been doing his best to get ahead in life, and he's got these two sons, and the time comes that he divides his inheritance up among his sons, and he said he divided to them his living here. So we know that there was this younger son, he come up and he's looking for his inheritance. And I would just simply say here today that this is something that God really instills in the heart of his people, is to be a provider. In fact, one of the great Bible names that we know of the Lord is Jehovah Jireh, the Lord that provides, the Lord shall provide. It's only part of our natures as Christians, I believe, that we have this strong desire birthed in us. It's and especially among the men of the church, we have to accept our responsibility before God, that it is our responsibility to provide for our family. And I pray that you'd see that this is a wonderful attribute of love. It's something in your heart that you should love your family and say, I love my family. See, if the motivation for going off to work in the morning, or maybe day after tomorrow now, seeing as how we're celebrating our Labor Day or Independence Day weekend this weekend, and tomorrow you'll be off most likely, but many are not. But I'm just saying, the inspiration for going off to work is not necessarily just the paycheck in itself, but the inspiration for doing this is called love. I go off to work because I love my family. It's my place to make sure that my family is provided for. And it was all my young years of working and growing. As I grew older, I had David and Jody at home and my wife, and we worked hard to make things work. And that's just part of life that God puts out there. But you got to see that the real motivation wasn't necessarily just the paycheck, but it was the love. And so I pray this morning that you just let that love come alive in your heart, and you say, you know what? I love my children, and I want to do right by them all the days of my life. But do you know that God's got even a larger plan for you? That God has a plan that this love is to, if you will, be enlarged as your family grows? You know, whenever Joy and I started our journey almost 43 years ago, whenever we got married, you know, just she and I, we sat down at that little bitty table that we had in that little bitty room that we was in, and up there at Okmulgee, and it was just she and I. You know, that little bitty table and two little chairs. Well, now you come out to my house at lunchtime, and whenever David and Jody show up with their crew, and me and Joy sit down there and everything, there's 12 of us. I mean, the family had just, you know, be fruitful and multiply. It happened. And anyway, it was a good thing. But, you know, the thing that I need you to understand here is God not only put the love in my heart to provide for my boys whenever they were small, but now God has given me some revelation understanding about what am I supposed to do for these grandkids. In fact, look in your Bible to book of Proverbs right quick, and just let the Lord show you something here that I think will bless you here. Proverbs chapter 13, it says in verse number 22, a good man leaveth an inheritance to his what? Children's children, and the wealth of the sinner is laid up for the just. See, my vision now is not just for whenever my days on this earth are over with. I want to leave something for David and Jody and their family. But I've got these grandkids. You know, every once in a while you'll be driving down the road and you'll see somebody in a great big RV or camper hooked up behind a fifth wheel, and you'll fifth wheel trailer hooked up behind a big truck, and they're going down the road and everything. And on that, they'll have a bumper sticker back there, and it says, "I'm spending my children's inheritance." Well, that's a violation of God's word, ladies and gentlemen. See, God had put it in here that not only are we to be doing this now, whenever they're little guys, but God is saying, I want you to lay up an inheritance for your children's children. This is what this father did in the Gospel of Luke here. He had this love in his heart that he had been preparing for this very day. Whenever his sons would come to him and say, Father, we'd like to have whatever it is that you'd like to give us. And so the father divided up the inheritance and shared it with his children. And I think that it's important that we get a hold of this wonderful truth here today, that we'd say that's a portrait of love. Whenever a man loves his family, and he's not just concerned about the present day, but he's looking down the road of his life. And he said, one of these days when my time is done, I'm going to make sure that not only my children are going to get something, but also my children's children. So my grandchildren, they have every reason to believe that whenever my days is gone, Poppy's going to leave me something. And it's going to be besides an empty box. I'm going to have something in that box for them to get. It's something they'll enjoy. But you know what Joy and I, we've come to terms with? We didn't want to just wait, kind of like this father here. We didn't want to wait till when all of our days are all spent to see our sons and our grandchildren enjoying things. We try to do good things for our children and our grandchildren on a real regular basis. We'll do little things that'll just bless them, just to be a blessing. How many of you believe you're blessed? Say amen. Amen. You're blessed, ladies and gentlemen. And so if you really want to get some joy out of what you've been working hard and putting back and everything, learn to share while they're still here. Learn to bless them, be a blessing to them. How many of you know God wants you not only to recognize you are blessed, but he wants you to be a blessing? Amen. And ladies and gentlemen, if we're going to bless somebody, why can't we start right our own home? Why can't we start with our own children, our own grandchildren? And I would just encourage you to let that, and the reason why that becomes real to me is because I love my sons. I love their wives. I love my grandchildren. And I'm telling you, this thing is real in my heart. And so Joy and I, we just try to be a blessing. And that's what I intend to continue to do. As long as God leaves me here on this earth, I just want to choose to be a blessing. Okay? So anyway, let's look at verse number 13. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. Well, the father believed in giving his children their freedom. The younger son come and he wanted to go. And this is the tough one, I think, for parents. Giving your children freedom. Matter of fact, we're celebrating Independence Day, which is freedom. That's what we love about America. We're free. God wants you to know this is a picture of a father that is willing to give his son the freedom to choose. There's something to be said about that. Sometimes it's hard for a man and his wife to let their children make choices and go and do what needs to be done with their life. I just want to encourage everybody to learn from this. This is a portrait of love. Love is the ability to let go and let somebody make a choice. And that's what God, in fact, does with all of us. We have a choice. We have a choice to be free in the salvation of the Lord Jesus Christ. Be free from sin. Jesus said, if the Son of Man sets you free, you'll be free indeed. Somebody say amen. Amen. See, I'm so grateful today that old sin nature that once controlled me, is that Jesus come along. And man, I tell you, he set me free. Amen. But you know, I learned As I raised my own two sons, David and Jody, they got up, you know, where it was time for you know, them to start having some liberties and making some choices. There were some choices that maybe they made that I wouldn't approved of, but I learned that this is part of helping them to develop and helping them to grow up as well. Because every one of us in this room, we understand what it means to kind of be like this young son. He went off and He didn't live the life that maybe his dad would have wanted him to have lived. He went off down there, and maybe it gives us a little bit of insight right here about this younger son that might need to be qualified at this point in time as well. I noticed that this younger son, He got what his dad gave him, and he went off and he lived in righteous living. In other words, he just began to please his flesh. I'd like for you to turn in your Bibles to the book of Proverbs, and let me show you something here that I think also stands out as very notable as well. Proverbs chapter 22, listen to this. This is such a powerful scripture verse, and we really do need to let the Word of God come alive concerning our finances. Listen to this. Verse number 6 of Proverbs 22. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Now, a lot of people love this for evangelistic reasons, and maybe they got a child that's out there in the world, and you know, they say, well, you know, I raised that kid in the church. I taught him to honor the Lord, and now look where they're at, out there in the world. And God gives you hope and gives you faith with this verse here, because you know that where that child's at right now is maybe not where you'd like to see him to be, but you hold on to this promise because you say, I trained him up in the ways of the Lord, and I know this is not the end of the story. God's going to get him back. And thank God that's true, that there is another, there's more to the story right now than maybe where your son or your daughter's at. But you hold on to this promise and you say, I know that they're going to come back to God because I raised them in the house of the Lord. I trained them upright. But in fact, this scripture verse, if you tie it into to really the context of scripture, it really reveals something perhaps that we're reading about in the Gospel of Luke that is maybe a breakdown here. Look what it says in verse number 7 here. And it says here in verse number 7 of Proverbs 22, you're training up his child in the way he should go, and when he grows old, he'll not depart from it. But look what you've trained him up in. The rich ruleth over the poor, and the borrower is servant to the lender. The thing about it is that I believe that needs to be done by all of us that are parents here today. We need to realize that maybe the breakdown that caused this younger son to go away is revealed in Scripture here. This younger son, he went away and he lived in riotous living. In other words, he didn't manage his finances. You see, it shows us here in Proverbs 22:7 that the borrower is servant to the lender. And the rich ruleth over the poor there. So what you find here is many times there's a breakdown here in people's lives. Moms and dads raise up their children, and to a great degree, they do them a great injustice if you do not train them up on how to manage your finances. I mean, ladies and gentlemen, I deal with grown men and women that cannot balance a checkbook. I mean, they don't know how to manage their finances. Did you notice in the Gospel of Luke right here that there's no mention to this younger son whenever he got his inheritance, that the first thing that he did, he went up to the house of God and he paid his tithes on what his dad had given him? Yet this is an area that needs to be taught. We got to teach our sons and our daughters, our grandchildren, we got to teach them that whenever God blesses you with something, you got to tithe. You got to get a hold of this. Don't let the shout go out of meeting, because I'm not hanging up on this subject right here for no good reason. I'm trying to help you to see that this younger son was failing in the area of not managing his finances. Amen. The father did his part. He believed. He believed in going over here and giving his children freedom. But I think that really what we see here is this young son, he had the freedom to do with his finances as he chose. So we have the freedom to spend our finances. So I ask you this morning, is that something that you're doing? Are you training up your sons and your daughters to come to these altars during the invitation or during offering time and put their tithe and offering in the offering box? Do you train them to do that? Because if you don't, all they're going to be listening to is the dictates of their flesh. Amen. Let me ask you this second part of this. Doesn't show me in the scripture here that neither does this younger son go up to the house of God and pay tithes on what his dad gave him. But you know the greater tragedy here as well, or one of the great tragedies as well in this story here is, as I see it, the young son did not believe in saving. You'd be surprised how many of God's children have never taught their sons and daughters to save. Amen. It's up to you, ladies and gentlemen, to realize that this is part of God's plan. That you be a tither, that you be a person that knows how to manage your finances, that you know how to save. Many of you here in the house of God, and I'm not trying to step on nobody's toes, I'm just trying to make you wake up and think about something. If you had to come up with $1,000 today, $1,000 in cash, could you do it? There's many of you that couldn't. I'm not trying to step on your toes for no good reason. I'm trying to help you to see something. The way you less, if you go back in the book of Proverbs and you study about the little ant, the parable or the story about the little ant, he said, go and consider the ant who, having no master or overseer, goes out and provides for her substance. In other words, she goes out and works all summer long, back and forth to the out in the field, gathering up little seeds, going down in the ground, storing it in a little storehouse here. God says, consider this ant. It doesn't have anybody telling it what to do, but it knows instinctively, I better store up. Why? Because, ladies and gentlemen, you lessen the impact of a hardship if you've been a saver. Amen. If you've got something to fall back on. And every sound money manager will tell people, you got to save. And I would just say this, if God's minimum on giving is 10%, the tithe is 10%, whatever God bless you with, you give, bring 10% of that and put it in God's house, all right? Why don't you do the same thing for your saving? Why don't you make a discipline in your life, say, I am going to start saving? And this is part of what this younger son's failure, as I see it, was really a breakdown. You see, the scripture taught, train up a child in the way he should go. And that's all well and good evangelistically speaking, but you got to keep it in context and you'll realize it was dealing with finances. This is where the younger son had really his freedom. His freedom was, you choose what you want to do with this, son. And the younger son shows us that he really was listening to his flesh and not lining up with the Word of God. So I want to encourage you this morning to realize this is a freedom that God gives you. You're going to have finances in your hand. What are you going to do with it? And I would say wisdom would step to the forefront and say, you be a tither, first of all. Secondly, you come over here and you say, I'm going to be a person that saves. So I hope that'll help you and guide you in the right way, where you're not out here just living from paycheck to paycheck and can't wait to go and blow whatever it is you make. Okay? Thirdly, let's look at this in conclusion here. In verse number 20 it says, and he arose and came to his father, but when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. The third and final thing this morning, the father believed in giving forgiveness. You see, this to me is the whole totality of God the Father right here. God the Father loves giving you forgiveness. Somebody say amen. Amen. The younger son, he comes home. I mean, ladies and gentlemen, he'd been out in the pig pen, just eating whatever the pig could get. You know, he just out there by himself. But one day, the day finally came, the circumstances finally got a hold of him, and he came to himself. The Bible declares that he came to himself. Can I tell you something? You got to be out of your mind to walk out on God. Amen. You really do. But he came to himself, and he said, I need to just go home. In other words, he was homeless. I just want to say, I want to interject this right quick, if I might. Homeless. Have you ever been homeless? Ladies and gentlemen, that is a terrible place to be, homeless. This is where this younger son was at. He was homeless. But he had a home to go to. Can I tell you one day, friend, this life's going to come to an end for each and every one of us as long as the Lord tarries. God wants you to have an eternal home. That means you need to have Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior so you can have an eternal home. God doesn't want you to be homeless. He wants you to know you got a heavenly home waiting on you. If you're here this morning and you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, may today be the day that you, maybe like this young son, you say, I just want to go home. Okay? Now, more in line with this, the younger son coming home, is the fact that he's really in a backslidden condition. You know, this is something that the old devil try to beat you up with. If you're in a backslidden condition today, old devil would try to beat you up and say, they don't want you back there. Ain't nobody want you at that church. Can I tell you this morning, that's the love of Jesus Christ that God put in my heart. You're welcome here. Amen. You're welcome here. God wants you to know He loves you. And I'll just say this. If you don't have a church home here this morning, and God puts it in your heart to come to Glory Bound Church, I want you to know, I want you to come. That's what I want. That's what I believe God would say, that we need to really realize here is a child that had made a lot of bad choices. In the freedom that he had, he made a lot of bad choices, and he wound up in a mess in his life. But the last thing that God would want any of us here today to do is to pick up a rock and throw at you for making some bad choices. Can I tell you something, ladies and gentlemen? The Bible says we all like sheep have gone astray. Amen. You know, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. In fact, the scripture shows me, I'll just show you here. Turn over to the book of Galatians right quick. Would you turn there right quick? And I just think this is an important thing for you to see. This is found in Galatians chapter 6. Listen to what Paul writes here. In verse number 1, brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, we're in Galatians 6:1. Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore. Everybody say restore. Restore such a one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. What I'm trying to show you here this morning, here is a father that believed in giving forgiveness. This younger son shows up at the door. I mean, the father sees him coming at a great way off, and he runs to his younger son, embraces him, kisses him, oh, loves on him. Can I tell you, that's what God is trying to show us. He has just been waiting for you to make a decision. I need to come home. Who among us here this morning needs to come home? I mean, you've made it this far. You decided, well, I'm going to go to church on Sunday morning. Praise God for your decision. That's what this younger son did. He decided, you know what? I need to just go home because that's where he belonged. Can I tell you, this is where you belong? You belong in God's house. And so it is forgiveness that God offers to each and every one that has gone astray and made bad choices in their state of freedom that they enjoyed. Maybe you've made some bad choices, friend. But I promise you, I'll be the last one to ever criticize or condemn you. I'm not going to do it. In fact, what I'm going to do, I'm going to do my part according to Galatians 6:1. I'm going to do my best to restore you. You see, I believe that's what people ultimately are looking for in a church. They're looking for the love of Jesus Christ. That's what they're looking for. And ye which are spiritual, restore such a one in a spirit of meekness. I've been out there, ladies and gentlemen. I've been out there backslid. I know what it's like to finally yield to God and say, I need to go home. Amen. And if I'd have walked into a cold and indifferent and rejecting church, I'd have probably still been out there in the world. But you see, the thing that brought me on in was the way the people of the church received me and loved on me and my family, encouraged me, inspired me. And I've never forgot that. So today, not only do I have a great heart for evangelism, I got a great heart for restoration. Amen. This younger son, he came home and he did not receive rejection. He received forgiveness. I want to ask you right quick to just consider this as my final thought here for today. How many of you are thankful for God's forgiveness? Say amen. Amen. I am. I am so thankful for God's forgiveness. But can I tell you something here this morning? I believe the reason why God put this so heavy on my heart is because there's a call of God to not only receive forgiveness, but there is a call of God to give forgiveness. Amen. This father gave forgiveness. Listen to what the scripture says in the book of Ephesians in closing here. In Ephesians chapter 4, so, preacher, that's the fourth time you said closing, and we ain't closed yet. Verse 32 of Ephesians 4 says, and be ye kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. Amen. Forgiveness is not only something, ladies and gentlemen, we receive from God, but because we understand it and appreciate it so much, God says, now I want you to give it. Who do you know today that needs your forgiveness? They didn't make good choices. Maybe it's a child of yours, a grandchild, a spouse. Maybe they didn't make good choices. This is why this passage of Scripture in the Gospel of Luke becomes so real. Mom, Dad, sibling. It's because whenever this younger son came home, he received forgiveness from his father. This is where you're going to be at, ladies and gentlemen. This is how you put the rubber to the road of the gospel message of Jesus Christ this morning. As God brings you to a place of making another decision. Maybe you're here this morning and you're not so much in need of God's forgiveness and coming home, and maybe that part of it is not where you're at. But this is maybe where God's going to bring you to. That you're faced, like this father, with a situation of somebody that made some poor choices in life. And because of their poor choices, you've been walking around with resentment and bitterness in your heart, anger in your heart. You've been wondering how come you're so unhappy and sad. We're right here. Look at verse 30 of Ephesians 4. And it says, "And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you're sealed until the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice." You've been unhappy because of the words and the actions of this person, this younger son that went out and made poor choices and lived like the devil, and she's been doing crazy things, or he's been doing crazy things that you disapprove of, and yet, but the only thing you've been able to do is just focus on how mad it's made you. It's upset you so terribly. And because of that, now you've grieved the Holy Spirit because you haven't operated in the realm of God's Word that teaches you to forgive. So who among your family and friends is God pointing out to you, "I need you to forgive them"? Come to this altar during this invitation. Get on your knees and say, "Father, I forgive them." Let the love of Jesus come back into your life the way God needs it to operate. Show the love of Jesus to them. Forgive them. Today is a wonderful day. We can be so thankful for the forgiveness of God. But we also need to realize that just as this father gave out forgiveness to his young son that had made so many mistakes with his young life, instead of the father saying, "Get out there with the hired servants," like the young son thought that he would wind up being, the father completely restored him. Can I tell you, God wants to restore you today, ladies and gentlemen. Please stand with me. Father in heaven, we're so grateful today for this time together here in the house of the Lord. And Father, as we come to this part of the service that we call the invitation, Father, I pray that your word and your spirit has touched our hearts and our lives. Lord, may we have the conviction to provide for our families just as you provide for us, Lord. May we settle it in our heart. It's our responsibility. The men of the house of God need to accept this as their commitment to you. It's our place to provide for our family, not only our present family that we have, but even our extended family, Lord, our grandchildren. Lord, may we be a blessing to as many people as we can be in our lifetime. And Lord, I just pray for your spirit to show us the importance of living right in the freedom that you give us. Lord, we have a freedom that we live in because you set us free. And we're not to use this freedom for an occasion for the flesh. God, if we've, like this younger son, made some bad choices, maybe we need to come to these altars today and just ask for your forgiveness. I pray that we will. And Lord, lastly, if we're among the people here like this father that believed in giving forgiveness to his young son, God, maybe there's somebody here today that knows in their heart they need to pay this forgiveness forward, Lord, that you gave to them. Lord, if we have aught or bitterness in our heart towards anybody, may we come to these altars and God just forgive them. And may we get things right here today. And I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Right now, the altars are open. If God puts it in your heart to come, would you come right now? Don't wait on anybody else, friend. Come on.